Well, good morning and welcome to St. Paul's Online Church. Here we are again, meeting in this place rather than in our usual place of worship, St. Paul's Church building. We are disparate, we are spread out, and yet we are gathering together to worship the Lord. So welcome as you switch on, click on, whatever is relevant to you. Welcome to our service this morning on Sunday, May the 10th. It's good to be with you, even though it still feels strange to be doing it in this way. Today, we are looking at John 14, verses 1 to 14, and considering that incredible statement that Jesus made, that he is the way to the Father. And Susan Nightingale will be preaching for us on that. So we have that to look forward to. And a very special Lord's Prayer this week too. It's been good fun putting that together, and I hope you're blessed by that approach to the Lord's Prayer this week. Just no sneak previews, just wait until it appears in the service and you'll see what I mean. I hope you enjoy it. But for now, as we gather again, and it's good for us to be gathering again, it's my prayer that in these moments, in moments like these, the Lord gives you a sense, a real sense, that you belong to something bigger, bigger than your front room, your study, your kitchen, your sofa, wherever you happen to be when you engage with our service in this way. I hope the Lord, by his Spirit, gives you a sense that you belong to something bigger, something way bigger than where you are right now, that you belong to him and that you belong to his people. A huge worldwide people who hold to faith in Jesus Christ. And through that, we're all united as the body of Christ on earth. We belong to something bigger. Peter, in his first letter, he put it like this, 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning at verse 9. He says, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." Hear those words of you being declared a holy nation, of you being declared a chosen people. Let's remember these truths as we gather together to declare the praises of him who has taken us from, as it says in this passage, out of darkness and placed us into his marvellous light. As we gather for that purpose, let's pray together. Father God, thank you for our identity that's ours in your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. An identity that puts us in your family, your people, your holy nation, and in the midst of your light. Fill us by your Spirit and inspire us to declare your praises. Help us to know in our hearts the reality of who we are in Jesus, and empower us to offer you praise that will bless your name. Come into our rooms by your Spirit. Fill us, change us, mold us, move us as we worship you together. We pray this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Earlier on in that passage, that same chapter, 1 Peter chapter 2, when Jesus is describing who he is and who we are in him, he describes himself as a stone that was laid in Zion. Verse 6 I'm reading from here. "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame." I mention that verse because our first song this week produced by our very clever musicians who are recording things in different homes, but somehow Abby is managing to bring them together into one video. Our first song is Cornerstone. So please just join with them as we worship the Lord Jesus, the Lord of all.
Today's reading is taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 14. John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 14. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, Show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. This is the word of the Lord.
Welcome to you. My name's Susan Nightingale. I'm one of the licensed lay ministers at St Paul's, and it's my privilege to share some thoughts with you today on this passage in John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 14. And the sermon's called, Jesus Said, I Am the Way. So as we look at God's word together, let's pray. Lord, as we come to your word, please speak to us, move amongst us, and touch our hearts afresh with your love, that we might see Jesus today. Amen. Now, John 14 begins with some wonderful words of comfort from Jesus. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Words that seem particularly appropriate at this time, but spoken here to his disciples the night before Jesus died. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not allow anxiety and worry to overwhelm you, Jesus says. How easy it is to read and hear these words, but how much harder it is to put them into practice. And particularly hard at the moment, perhaps, because we are in the midst of a terrible worldwide pandemic. The cloud of suffering, physical, mental, and economic, has descended upon us. And in the last few weeks, so much of what we have relied upon, taken for granted, has been whipped from under us. Our world has changed and become a much scarier place. But you know, the disciples to whom Jesus speaks these words were also undergoing incredible turmoil. They were celebrating the Passover meal with Jesus when events began to take a worrying and ominous turn. Because Jesus drops the bombshell that one of them will betray him, and they watch as Judas disappears into the night to carry out the dirty deed. But there was more to follow. Jesus goes on to talk of leaving them. Now, we know, of course, that Jesus was talking of his death, but the disciples haven't cottoned on. Bewildered, Peter asks the question, where are you going? Only to be told that he would not be able to go where Jesus was going now, but would be able to follow later. It must have seemed to them that Jesus was talking in riddles. And then when Peter boldly declares his loyalty to Jesus, Jesus replies with a devastating statement that by the following dawn, Peter will have denied him three times. As a result of all this, the disciples are understandably shaken to the core. But then Jesus speaks these wonderful words of comfort in verse 1 of chapter 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. Or just as you have always trusted in God, so you can also trust in me. The disciples can trust Jesus in the midst of all their confusion and anxiety because of who Jesus says he is. And that all centres around verse 6, where Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Which I think you'll agree is an extraordinary statement by any stretch of the imagination. I am the way. I am a person. I am the way. Not a set of rules, not a regime, but me. But Jesus is the way to what? To success, financial security, happiness? No, none of these. In this passage, Jesus sets out to explain that he is the way to three far more important things. He is the way to the Father's house, or heaven. He is the way to the Father's presence, and he is the way to the Father's work. Jesus alone is the way to all these things. Nothing or no one else is the way. Not religion, not good works, not piety, nothing else. Only Jesus is the way to the Father's house or heaven. Jesus alone is the way. So firstly, do not let your hearts be troubled, because Jesus is the way to the Father's house or heaven. Verse 2. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place I am going. The way to the Father's house is all about Jesus. Listen again. I am going there to prepare a place for you. I will come back and take you to be with me, so that you also may be where I am. The way to heaven is Jesus himself. Now this is a familiar passage, often spoken at funerals. And here, on the eve of his death, Jesus is assuring the disciples that through believing and trusting in him, they can know a place in heaven with him. Jesus speaks of the Father's house as having many rooms. It's a family home for the children of God, where they can live for all eternity. It's not a hotel, it's not a premier inn, good as they are. It's not somewhere for guests to stay a while as they pass through, but a permanent home where the children of God will dwell with their heavenly Father. And Jesus says he is going there to prepare a place for them. But what does he exactly mean? They say, don't they, that during this lockdown we have focused on the home and particularly on cleaning and tidying. But it's not that the Father's house is a mess and needs a spring clean. The rooms are there, ready and waiting. But the doors are locked. And Jesus is saying to the disciples, you can't go in there yet until I have opened the door for you. and the only way the door can be opened will be through my blood shed on the cross at Calvary. For by his death, Jesus would pay the penalty for the sins of the whole world, past, present, and future. And that gaping chasm between sinners and a holy God would be bridged. And looking ahead to the crucifixion in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 27, we see confirmation there that this was accomplished. Because at the very moment that Jesus breathed his last, we're told that the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now, the curtain screened the Holy of Holies, the place of God's presence. No one was allowed access, only the priest, and then only once a year to offer sacrifices for the sins of the people. But as a result of Jesus' death, of his one sacrifice offered once for sin, God tore the curtain from top to bottom, from heaven to earth, to signify that the way to eternal life had been spectacularly opened. The doors to the rooms in the Father's house had been unlocked through the death of his Son. There's an old chorus we used to sing. There's a way back to God from the dark paths of sin. There's a door that is open and you may go in. At Calvary's cross is where you begin when you come as a sinner to Jesus. When you come as a sinner to Jesus, you discover the wonderful truth that he himself is the way to the Father's house. Faith in Jesus shatters the barriers of sin and death and blasts open the road to eternal life and the kingdom of God. But what Jesus is also saying here to his disciples is that they will not make that final journey to the Father's house alone. Jesus says, "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. I will come back and take you to be with me, so that you also may be where I am." Jesus himself, when he returns again in all his glory at the end of the age, to judge the living and the dead, will gather up his people and take them home, and they will be with him forever. "That you also may be where I am," Jesus said. Ultimately, heaven is being where Jesus is. What a wonderful assurance. The process of death is never easy, but we can have faith in Jesus as our Saviour, as the only one who can save us from our sin. We can trust in him to take us home to be with him forever. So do not let your hearts be troubled, because Jesus is the way to the Father's house. Secondly, do not let your hearts be troubled, because Jesus is the way to the Father's presence. When Jesus says in verse 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," he also says, "No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus alone is the way to the Father. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus is stressing that salvation is found only in him. In Acts 4, verse 12, Paul writes this: "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven by which we must be saved." No other religion can bridge the gap I spoke about earlier, the gap that exists between God and sinners. Christianity alone is unique in that God came in the person of Jesus Christ to deal with sin by bridging that gap and bringing reconciliation with God. Jesus is saying very clearly that, contrary to some thinking, all roads do not lead to God. All religions are not the same. Let me show you what I mean. Capitalism and communism are both forms of politics, but I think you'll agree they're very different. Giraffes and monkeys are both animals, but again, they're very different. Likewise, there are many religions, but they are all different. The only road that leads to God is the one marked Jesus. No one comes to the Father except through faith in me, says Jesus. I am the way to the Father, and if you really knew me, you'd know the Father. Now, poor old Philip doesn't understand this and says to Jesus in verse 8, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. That will be sufficient. To which Jesus tries to explain that everyone who knows Jesus also knows the Father because they are one. Jesus describes it in verse 11 as him being in the Father and the Father being in him. They only have to look at Jesus, at who he is, and they will see the Father. Later in the Bible, in Hebrews 1, verse 3, we read this. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. Listen to that. The exact representation of his being. Not a likeness or a similarity, but the exact representation of God. Jesus is God in human form. And from now on, Jesus says, because of his death, the disciples and the world would see in a most spectacular way just who the Father is. There will be a mighty revelation of the Father. They will see the wonder and the magnitude of the love of the Father poured out for all in the sacrifice of his Son to bring mankind back to himself. And in this act of supreme obedience by the Son, the revelation of the Father will be complete. Now, throughout the ages, humankind has sought to answer the question, who is God? People have searched for him in a whole variety of places. But the amazing truth is that we can know God, we can have a relationship with him through his Son Jesus. God can be real to us. We can know his presence in our daily lives because Jesus is the way. When we know Jesus, we know God. So do not let your hearts be troubled, because Jesus is the way to the Father. And finally, do not let your hearts be troubled, because Jesus is the way to the Father's work. Jesus says in verse 12, I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. I tell you the truth, Jesus says to his disciples. You can trust what I say to be true. The evidence that you are a child of God is that just like me, you will do the Father's work. I am the way to the Father's work. Not only will you do what I have been doing, but you will do even greater things. Which begs the question, how can they do even greater things than Jesus? Right from the beginning of Jesus' ministry, we are told that he was proclaiming the gospel and calling people to repentance and faith. But we know too, don't we, that Jesus was also performing miracles, healing the sick, even raising the dead. So is Jesus saying to his disciples that they will do even greater things than raising the dead? Well, no. the even greater things here are the miracles of regeneration, of people turning to God in even greater numbers, and the gospel being preached to the ends of the earth. Because although the disciples do perform some physical miracles, we find as we read through the Acts of the Apostles that these become less, and it is the miracle of regeneration that becomes more and more apparent. People turning to God. This is what Jesus is talking about here. The even greater things. For can there be anything greater than people turning to God? This is the Father's work, proclaiming the gospel so that hearts will turn to him. And the reason Jesus can promise his disciples that they will be able to do all this is, strangely perhaps, because of his impending departure. Because Jesus makes it clear from verse 16 onwards that after his return to heaven, he will send the gift of the Holy Spirit, who will equip them, embolden them, and enable them to spread the gospel. And we see evidence of the outworking of this in Acts, where we read that Peter preached at Pentecost and more people came to faith than all those put together in Jesus' ministry. And by the end of Acts, we read that Paul, who had persecuted the early Christians before an encounter with the Lord, boldly and without hindrance preached the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the Father's work, and it is the mission of the church, of you and I. Helped by the Holy Spirit, we are to share the good news of Jesus, the greater things Jesus is talking about here. But we can only do this when we know Jesus and have a relationship with him. And preaching and sharing the good news is not just about standing up in a pulpit or in large stadiums. It's about praying for and talking to your friends and family, your neighbours. This lockdown is horrible. It has prevented us from meeting together. It's curtailed our activities. But it has opened up lots of other opportunities to share with others. Suddenly, we are having conversations with our neighbours, with people we hardly know. Perhaps we are able to offer practical help or offer to pray for them, to direct them to the church website and other resources. Let us make good use of this time of isolation. But as we come to a close, I'd just like to stress that although Jesus says he is the only way, he invites all to come to him and accept him as their Lord and Saviour. No one is excluded. Because Jesus also says in John chapter 6, whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. Young, old, poor, rich, clever, not so clever, whatever your past, whatever your doubts and fears, when you come to Jesus, he will welcome you with arms opened wide. So if you don't truly know Jesus, come to him today. You will not regret it. And all I have spoken of will be for you, just as it is for all who already know him. In the midst of these difficult times, amidst the anxiety and the turmoil, do not let your hearts be troubled. Because Jesus is the way to the Father's house, your future is assured. Jesus is the way to the Father's presence. Your relationship is secured. and Jesus is the way to the Father's work, your mission is established. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you are the way, the truth, and the life. May we take comfort from this today and in the days to come, knowing that in you we have no need to be afraid. Encourage and help us to find ways of sharing this good news with others, that they too may enjoy the joy and peace of a relationship with you. Amen.
Let's pray together. Let us come in prayerful worship to the Father. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the sheep of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Father, we acknowledge that you are in control and that you know all things during this difficult time of lockdown. And Lord, we pray that it would be an opportunity for us to draw close to you through the Lord Jesus and hear what you are saying to us individually and as a church in these days. May we have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches and to us. And Father, we pray for the lonely, we pray for the sick and the vulnerable,
at this time and those affected by the coronavirus. Father, we pray for those separated from seeing their families and friends. Lord, we pray for your healing and for your comfort for all those affected. And Lord, that you would heal the brokenhearted and comfort and strengthen them by your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we pray that you would bring good out of this tragic and terrible situation, and that many would return to you and turn to you in these days, and many would call upon your name. Lord, we pray that we would be good witnesses to our neighbours and to all who we meet, that we would just minister your love and grace and mercy and be ready to give a word in season and a reason for the hope that is within us. And Father, we pray for Boris Johnson and the government. Lord, at this time, we thank you, Father, for Boris Johnson's recovery and for all those that were looking after him. And Lord, we pray that he may turn to you with his whole heart and ask for your help. Lord, we pray that he would receive your wisdom and guidance with the difficult decisions that lie ahead concerning the lockdown, as to when and how to lift it. Lord, we pray for this nation and all nations across the world, that during this time of shaking, where everything is being shaken and changed, and we wonder if things will ever go back to normal again or not, but that Lord, during this time, many would turn to you in faith and repentance. Lord, we lift up your name today in this nation. Lord, the name which is above every other name, the name of Jesus. And Lord, we also remember our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world who are being persecuted, suffering violence and discrimination for their faith in you, and made worse by the coronavirus. Lord, we just pray that you would stretch out your hand, Lord, to these dear ones in a special way, Lord. And Lord, that you would bring relief and help in their time of suffering, Lord. Lord, that you would strengthen their faith, Lord, in the power of your Holy Spirit. And that you would be real to them in a special way at this time. Lord, we just commit them to you now. And Lord, we commit ourselves to you afresh, to your love and care today. And we thank you that you know all about us, Lord. You know our sitting down, as the psalmist says, and our rising up. And you understand our thoughts from afar. And may we know your presence in all that we do and all the places that we go. We ask for your continued protection and keep in power over each one of us, that our lives would be a blessing to all those who we meet. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Your kingdom come.
Your will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who sin against us.
Lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power,
and the glory are yours,
now and forever. Amen.
As we face up to the challenge to proclaim to the world that Jesus is the way. We need to pray for the Lord's blessing upon us, that his strength and courage might be in us to live out the gospel and to proclaim the gospel to those that we meet with and those we're in connection and communication with. But we're not going to conclude our service this week with me praying for blessing. We're going to use the blessing for our nation, the UK blessing that musicians from different churches around the UK have put together. We join with them in praying this blessing over our nation. And as we sing it and join in with them in this song, let's be praying too that this nation would be blessed. Blessed in strength to hold fast, to overcome this virus and the terrible cost it's bringing to bear on our nation, that we might see healing, that we might see restoration to wholeness, and we might see a release from the grip of the virus. But let's join with this blessing as we conclude our service together. And it's also worth saying at this point, hang on to the very end. There's information there about things that could help other people in being in touch with us locally at St. Paul's and being in touch with the hope, the National Hope prayer line, where there's hymns and prayers available to people on the end of a telephone. Those contact details will come right at the end of the service. But as we conclude, let's join with this blessing on our nation.
and pray a blessing. Manna rained down from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations.
And your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. And your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. And your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. And your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you.